Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst 14th December 2018. We have been discussing topics pertinent with prelims and mains, but we received few representations from the aspirant community that since the prelims is nearing by, which is just 170 days away, we have received requests to focus more on prelims. So we have changed the format of Smart Catalyst. From now on, we will be discussing the prelims topics every day, and there will be a weekend release of important mains topic. We cannot leave the mains topic altogether since we are preparing for prelims. After prelims, the time gap for mains is only 90 days. So there should be a constant update of relevant mains topics. For that reason, we will be releasing a weekly update of mains topics. Let's move to today's topics. We will be discussing these 8 topics today. The first one is related with the dispute settlement mechanism in WTO. Second is related with the appointment of chief information commissioners to the Central Information Commission. The third one is related with duty drawback rates for apparel manufacturers. The fourth is related with government e-marketplace. The fifth one related with the PCA norms. Sixth one related with groundwater extraction. Seventh one with rights for the senior citizens. And the last one is a year-end review released in PIB pertinent to Ministry of Labour and Employment. The first topic is related with the conflict between United States and other developing economies of the world, related with appellate body of the WTO. USA has been unilaterally blocking the appointment to the appellate body of WTO. This was highlighted even in Buenos Aires summit. This appellate body is an important organ of WTO in order to have a just and free global trade. US had few reservations over the functioning of the appellate bodies, hence it has been preventing the vacancies from being filled in the 7-member appellate body for the past 2 years. Now it has reached a situation where the 7-member body has only 3 members. Of them, 2 will be retiring this year, so that in December 2019, the appellate body will have no judges, no representatives, which would lead to the decimation of dispute settlement mechanism in WTO. So the countries, or the other member countries of WTO, the important member countries, say European Union, India and China, they have been undertaking initiatives, they have been organizing meeting in order to discuss with other member countries to find a solution for this stalemate. There was a 12 developing and developed economies met in a conference recently. There they decided to have an understanding on rules and procedures governing the settlement of disputes. There the transitional rules for outgoing appellate body members were discussed, where through which the member vacating their post after the completion of term, they will remain in the post till they complete the ongoing dispute settlement mechanism. This was discussed in the 12 country meet. Apart from the 12 countries, European Union, China, India, these three countries, they are batting for independence for the appellate body of WTO, and they reinstate the point that in order to maintain independence for the appellate body members, the members should have a single but long term, which cannot be, and this single but long term cannot be disturbed by any single country. Now we saw the different problems that is plaguing the appointment of members to the appellate body. Now let's go to the basics of WTO appellate body. This appellate body was established in the year 1995 under Article 17 of Rules and Procedures that define settlement of disputes in WTO. This dispute settlement body is a standing body having 7 members, and these 7 members of the appellate body are appointed by dispute settlement board. The members enjoy a term of 4 years, and this term is renewable. The basic qualification required for the candidates are authority and expertise in international trade law, and the member should be unaffiliated with any government. The member should not be a servant of any particular government. These are the basic qualifications. What is the major function of the appellate body? The appellate body can uphold, modify, or reverse the legal findings and conclusions of a panel. Whenever there is a trade-related dispute, WTO forms a panel and the panel gives a report. This appellate body has the power to uphold, modify, or reverse the legal findings identified by a panel over a particular issue. And final verdict or final outcome of the appellate body mechanism is bound to all parties of the dispute. And this appellate body has its headquarters in Geneva, Switzerland. The next article is related with the appointment of Chief Information Commissioner and other information commissioners. Right to Information Act 2005 was brought in order to bring in transparency and accountability into Indian governance. And the information commissioner, especially the Central Information Commissioner, act as an second appellate authority and the final acts as a final appellate authority for these provisions provided in Right Information Act 2005. This Central Information Commission is an independent statutory committee formed under the RTI Act 2005, and this has jurisdiction over central government bodies, public sector undertakings, and other authorities which has significant government stakes in it. What is the composition of this Central Information Commission? The commission is an independent statutory committee formed to ensure freedom of information to citizen. Transparency, freedom of information is a liberty granted to citizens in a democratic country. Knowledge is a right. The Central Information Commission has one Chief Information Commissioner and he is aided by 10 information commissioners. And what is the qualification prescribed for the members of the Central Information Commission? The person recommended to be an information commissioner should be a person of eminence in public life, and they should be having experience in the field of law, science and technology, governance, social service, management, journalism, and mass media. And the member should not hold any office of profit. They should not be a member of any legislative assembly or parliament. The members hold office till the age of 65 or have a fixed tenure of 5 years. The information commissioners are appointed by the president, recommended by a commission. The commission has prime minister, leader of opposition, and a union cabinet minister nominated by prime minister. And recently, Supreme Court has criticized the government in delayed appointment of Chief Information Commissioner. This was because the present Lok Sabha has no defined leader of opposition. Leader of opposition post is given to a party which has a minimum of 10% of total seats in Lok Sabha. Since no party apart from the BJP has more than 10% total seats in Lok Sabha, the leader of opposition post is vacant, and hence there is a delay in appointment of Chief Information Commissioner. This is a recent crisis going on in appointing Chief Information Commissioner. The appointed information commissioners, appointed Chief Information Commissioner can be removed by the president on two grounds. One, when he is proved to have committed any misbehavior, or when he is of incapacity. The procedure to be followed in removing a Central Information Commissioner members is as same to the removal of UPSC chairman and members. Apart from this, they can resign by writing to president. The next article is related with the apparel manufacturers' request on increasing the duty drawback rates. Recently, the government of India announced duty drawback rates for cotton ready-made garments at the rate of 1.8 and 2.2%. But the apparel manufacturers, they were looking for a 4.32% hike in duty drawback rates. Now they have submitted a request to the central government in order to increase the duty drawback rates. In this context, we have to understand what is a duty drawback. Duty drawback is a refund in payments that were initially collected upon import of foreign made goods. Let me explain this with an schematic diagram. What happens in textile industry? They import yarns from foreign countries, and in order to import, they have to pay customs duty and other import fees. The yarn which has been imported undergoes a process through which it is converted into a ready-made garment. This ready-made garment is again exported. The value of imported yarn is less. The value addition process by which the yarn is made into a ready-made garment is higher. The value is higher here. The export value is high, import value is low. The exports of the country increases through this process. But the manufacturers, the apparel manufacturers, they are pushed to pay customs duty and other import fees for the value addition process they undertake, through which they are improving the economy of the country. So duty drawback is provided on the customs duty and other import fees paid by the manufacturer. The customs department normally issues its refunds only when the imported merchandise is exported. The next article is about the newly launched National Mission on Government E-Market under Digital India Mission. The government had launched the Government E-Market portal in order to improve the efficiency of government procurement . And the new National Mission on Government E-Market portal has the objective to accelerate the adoption and use of procurement by the various government entities like central ministry, state governments and union territories, which also includes the other PSUs and local bodies. This mission aims at promoting inclusiveness by catapulting various categories of sellers and service providers. Introduction of technology-enabled platform reduces discretion in procurement. Discretion is the main source of corruption. By highlighting and communicating value addition process, the transparency has been increased in the government e-marketplace. Thereby, it is an initial step towards corruption-free governance. The lack of physical contact between the buyer and seller has enabled us to achieve cashless, contactless and paperless transaction, which also reduces corruption and increases transparency. And paperless transaction is the main objective of Digital India. Also, the government e-market portal aimed at increasing efficiency of government procurement and reducing the expenditure on procurement process. The mission also aims at making all types of products and services available in the portal. These five were the main objectives of National Mission on Government E-Market. This mission has been introduced under Digital India Initiative in order to improve transparency, efficiency and to reduce corruption in government procurement. The next item for prelims has been taken from PIB. Every year, PIB releases year-end review of different ministries. And today, we are discussing about the year-end review of Ministry of Labour and Employment. The main objective, the main functioning of Ministry of Labour and Employment is towards providing job security, wage security and social security for each and every worker in India. In 2017 budget, Finance Minister had proposed amalgamating all labour laws into four codes. Code on wages, code on industrial relation, code on occupational safety, health and working condition, code on social security and welfare. This was aimed at reducing the number of laws in the labor market. This was aimed at reducing the number of laws plaguing the labor market, thereby improving India's ease of doing business ranking. Of the four codes announced, The bill for code on wages has been introduced, and this is under the purview of Parliamentary Standing Committee for approval. The other codes are still under the drafting process. So the government has introduced four codes by amalgamating the different labour legislations and acts. Also, the government has launched a Shram Suvidha portal in order to ease the registration process for MSME. The review mentions that the government has successfully passed the Maternity Benefit Amendment Act 2017 and the Payment of Gratuity Amendment Act 2018. Apart from this, one important scheme under the Ministry of Labour and Employment is Pradhan Mantri Rojgar Protoshan Yojana. This scheme aims at providing financial security to workers earning lower wages. Till April 2018, apart from wage security for any labor for the case any individual, social security is more important. Social security for the laborers are provided through the provident fund. But for the people earning lower wages, there is a huge gap. Contribution is very less from the employer side and from the employee side. So the government stepped in order to provide social security for the low wage earners. Till April 2018, the employer part of PF contribution, 8.33% of the employer part of PF contribution was paid by the government. After April 2018, the government started to pay the whole 12% of employer contribution to the PF. This is aimed at improving the employment conditions in the country. These are the major initiatives undertaken by the Ministry of Labour and Employment this year. The next topic is related with prompt corrective action. Recently, the bankers have requested the new RBI governor in order to ease the PCA norms. In order to understand the rationale behind this request, we have to know what PCA is. PCA is Prompt Corrective Action Framework, was introduced by RBI in order to cut the menace of bad loan problem. The PCA framework is based on three parameters. One is asset quality. Second is capital adequacy. Third is profitability. The asset quality of a particular bank is measured by the quantum of non-performing assets. Capital adequacy is measured by the CRAR ratio maintained by the banks. And profitability is analyzed by the profit made by the bank over a particular group of assets. So these are the three parameters, and with these three parameters, the banks are classified into three levels: level 1, level 2 and level 3. Under level 1, there will be a restriction on director's salary and dividend distribution to the shareholders. In level 2, based on their performances in different parameters, they are ranked in level 1, level 2, level 3. In level 1 group, they have minor restrictions, like restrictions on director's salary and dividend distribution to the shareholders. When they breach the threshold of level 1 and reach the level 2, where the risk is more, there will be some restrictions on expanding branches of a particular bank. There will be certain hard decisions taken by the RBI, like forced merger or shutting down of a weak bank. These are the different actions that would be undertaken by the RBI when the banks assessed by these three parameters breach the risk threshold. As of now, around 12 banks are placed under the prompt corrective action frameworks. Of them, 11 are public sector banks. Since they are placed under prompt corrective action framework, they are unable to, their funds are locked and they are unable to provide more credit. This has caused credit crunch like situation in the country. These public sector banks are placed under the prompt corrective action framework because the gross NPA in the country's economy has crossed the dangerous 10 lakh crore mark. The rise in NPAs has necessitated the banks to improve the provisioning amount. Because of the provisioning amount, the capital adequacy has come down. So with the resolution processes undergoing, the banks are pushed to undertake many haircuts over this loan. So their profitability is coming down. The capital adequacy is decreasing, profitability is decreasing, the asset quality NPA is decreasing, hence they are placed in PCA. The stringent norms has affected the operational aspects of the banks. Hence the bankers have requested the RBI, newly appointed RBI governor, to ease the existing stringent PCA norms. The next article is related with the Central Groundwater Authority's proposal on imposing fees for groundwater extraction. Central Groundwater Authority is the apex body under the Ministry of Water Resources to oversee the groundwater resources available in the country. Of the total groundwater available in India, 90% is being used for agriculture and 10% is used for domestic and industrial uses. So the Central Groundwater Authority has decided to levy a water conservation fee on groundwater extracted by the industries and some sections of domestic uses. So this is not applicable to the agricultural extraction. This is only for the groundwater extracted for industrial purposes and for few domestic uses. So how they are defining the domestic users? The domestic users are defined as the households who extract water from the ground, who extract groundwater using a pipe which has diameter more than a 1 inch. The industrial units also includes mining dewatering units and other units which use groundwater for producing packaged drinking water. These two units have also included as industrial units. These two industries have to avail NOC from concerned authorities in order to extract groundwater. If they are not complying with the rules proposed by the Central Groundwater Authority, their extraction of groundwater will invite a fees. Also, the defense establishments, industries of defense related industries of defense sector, and the users who don't use electricity to extract water, they are exempted from paying the fees. The next article is related with the Supreme Court's opinion on basic rights of senior citizens. India is going through a phase of demographic shift. It is expected that most of the majority of Indian population would be in the employable age group between the ages of 15 and 59 by 2035. This demographic shift has also got impact on increase, as also indicates increasing number of senior citizens in the country. In 1951, the number of elderly persons in country was 1.98 crore. In 2001, it increased to 7.6 crore. And in 2011, it was 10.38 crores. The extrapolated data indicates that the 60 plus aged population in India would be 14.3 crore in 2021 and 17.3 crore in 2026. These increasing numbers indicate the need and necessity for having a policy, need and necessity for undertaking initiatives to protect the basic rights of aged people. Supreme Court has identified this emerging situation of increasing number of senior citizens in the country and has ruled about the lack of any provision in constitution to protect the rights of senior citizens. The court has also opined that the economic budgeting should not play a role in tightening the purse strings of the treasury to provide welfare actions to the senior citizens. Also, under the Welfare of Parents and Senior Citizens Act 2007, it is a statutory right for every person to provide dignity, health and shelter to their parents. These three components, dignity, health and shelter, they form the basic ethos of liberty. And this liberty is guarded by Article 21 of Indian Constitution. Hence, the Supreme Court has opined that providing dignity, health and shelter will fall under the ambit of Article 21. Human dignity is a basic right, fountainhead for other rights in the society. So the dignity of senior citizens has to be protected. Thank you.